Hey everyone, Chell here with Prismatic Powders. Spraying powder on parts may appear easy, and in some cases it is, but there's so much more to applying powder the right way than just waving your gun at your part and getting the powder to stick. As an applicator, you want to maintain consistent mill thickness on all your parts within a given job or project, let alone just keeping things consistent on one, and you want to be able to do this easily. So how is this done? In today's video, we're going to talk about all the factors that you need to be aware of and gain control of to maintain consistent coverage no matter what you're coating. The first consideration is gun settings. Getting gun settings optimized for the part and the powder is extremely important. For a professional system, you'll have control over voltage, current, airflow, and atomizing air. Part material and shape will also play a role in your voltage settings. For example, aluminum often requires a higher voltage setting than steel. However, the complexity of the part is also going to play a role. For example, the ideal voltage settings for a flat panel will typically be higher than spraying a part with tight spaces or Faraday cage areas. And this is because powder lays pretty easily on a flat surface, and for one coat applications, keeping the KVs in their higher range will benefit your transfer efficiency, and this will make it easier to maintain even coverage. However, this strategy doesn't work for more complex parts. For these, you need to change your game a bit by dropping the voltage and changing your technique. Air settings should also be adjusted for varying part shapes and geometries, as well as for different powders and environments. For example, dropping air settings for tight spaces will help the powder lay into these areas more easily because you'll help mitigate the chances of blowing powder out of them. And that's something that happens pretty easy when the airflow setting is too high. To prevent spitting and surging, adjusting the air settings may also be necessary because not all powders have the same density. Next, let's talk about spraying technique. For the most part, you can summarize spraying techniques as spraying distance, hand movements, and hand speed. This is the most important part of staying consistent because even if you don't have a professional powder coating system with a lot of features, you can overcome quite a lot with technique. So we'll break down each consideration for overall technique. Distance to the part. We'll start with that spraying distance. A distance of 6 to 12 inches from gun tip to part is the general target distance for most scenarios when spraying. Getting too close could result in inconsistent thickness because you can literally blow powder away from the area you're trying to spray if those air settings are too high, or it goes the other way and you can build up too much powder in a particular spot. It can also create back ionization. If you're too far, you won't have a powder cloud that is dense enough or focused enough to manage how you build the powder, and that powder cloud will have a weak charge and you lose transfer efficiency. So it is important to pay attention to the sweet spot for gun distance. The next consideration is hand movement and hand speed. Approaching each part as you spray with a deliberate plan is a good practice. You need to plan where to start and where to end on the part, and obviously this plan needs to vary depending on the part shape. So imagine you're spraying a bunch of parts that are flat and similar. It's very logical that you want to use the same technique for each part. For flat surfaces, I'll use a slot tip and use a 50% overlap vertically, then horizontally, and then I'll pull back and dust the entire surface. I use this technique for all flat surfaces. It's what I've adopted as a technique that works for me to keep me consistent. My hand speed will be determined by the powder output based upon the settings that I input for the gun to best suit the part and the powder. Hand speed is going to be adapted based upon the complexity of the part too. It plays a huge role in how you build mill thickness. Obviously, if my hand speed is slower, I will build mill thickness faster. I think of hand speed as being a complementary to powder flow settings. The more complex the part, the more difficult it's going to be to stay consistent. So it's important to assess each part and strategize before diving in. So if you've got multiple parts of the same complexity, adopt an easily repeatable plan for the part. For example, for parts with multiple tight spaces, aside from dropping the voltage and adjusting the air setting, I'll select a tip to suit the part and the powder, and I keep in mind that powder wraps and flows beyond where I'm pointing the gun, so it's going to gather and build on areas where I've not directly applied it. So what I like to do first is hit the tight spaces first. Then I'll evaluate where the powder is built up on the other areas of the part, and this is going to help me understand how many passes I should make on those spots as I continue on. It's really important to keep track of how many passes I have because that contributes to mill thickness consistency. These are just a couple of examples, but I think you get the idea of how to put this all together. The main point that I want to drive home is that you need to keep track of where your powder is going and how many passes you're making. Give yourself a beginning and an end point so that you can easily repeat a process. You'll struggle to get even coverage on complex parts without approaching it methodically and breaking it down piece by piece. Now we'll talk about fluidization. Properly fluidized powder will help prevent clumping and thus assist in keeping consistent flow through the gun. For metallic powders, this process will also keep that heavier metallic suspended with the rest of the powder so there's even distribution of metallic flakes in the powder cloud. If you're using a box feed system, you won't have the ability to fluidize in the same way, but at the very least, there will be an agitation of the powder which will help keep the powder from clumping, so it's more easily transferred up through the pickup tube. For some of the cheaper entry-level coating systems, you don't have this option and you may struggle a bit. As we've mentioned before in other videos, a crucial component to the whole powder coating process is having a good ground, because the charged powder is drawn to the grounded surface of the parts. A true earth ground is ideal because it's so much more effective than the alternative, like a chassis ground, but no matter what you've got, you have to make sure you're grounded to something. And in both cases, ensure that racks and hooks are clean, meaning that there is bare metal to bare metal contact with your parts, hooks, and racks. Powder buildup will act as an insulator, so if it's not properly stripped, your parts will not be grounded. Now you just want to be able to verify your results. Use a mill thickness gauge. This will help keep you on track so that you can make sure that your processes are working and that your work is consistent. Keep racks and hooks clean so powder doesn't build up and insulate the grounded surface. You can either do this through routine maintenance, whether you grind or peel the old powder from the racks. Some people like to wrap the racking surface in tin foil to inhibit powder buildup. Either way, the purpose is the same, and the point is to keep a good grounded surface. Hooks can be blasted, burnt off, or chemically stripped. By far the best thing that you can do is practice. Get practice on multiple parts of varying shapes and levels of difficulties, and then evaluate the results with a mill thickness gauge. Now that's it for this video. Hopefully it serves you and gives you some help on tactics that you can employ to dial in consistent mill thickness with your powder coating. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.